Good morning. Let us rejoice, for this is the day the Lord has made. This is none other than the house of God. Let us enter this place with joy and prayer. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us read responsively. Come to God's holy house, one and all. No one is excluded. Come and learn from God's wisdom. Come and receive help for life's journey. Come and feel God's welcome. Serve and proclaim God's welcome to us. God is great and greatly to be praised. Let us read together the invocation and Lord's Prayer. Eternal Spirit, in the shining city and in the shadowed valley, you are our God and you have promised to be with us always. Help us hear your call to our Lord and serve in grace and through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Good morning, church. So good to be here with you this morning. A happy summer to one and all. The heart of our church is summed up in these words. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Following the service, please join us downstairs in the parish hall, where you'll find something to nibble, something to sip, and someone to talk to. If you are a visitor or have a prayer request, please enter the information on a visitor card found in the pew rack and place it in one of our three collection boxes. Say a prayer for our youth and service team led by Reverend Laurie Burgess, who are on their way to Austin, Texas as we speak. Reverend Jimmy Only and his wife Colleen are in the city working at the New York City LGBT Pride March. Let us pray that these gatherings are free from violence. Today and tomorrow, our church is hosting Art in the Parish Hall, a fundraiser for the Katie Oppo Cancer Research Fund. The viewing is today from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. The fundraising portion of the project is tomorrow from 4 to 6 p.m. All of the art was created by Manhasset High School students around the theme, A Special Woman in Your Life. Many thanks to Manhasset High School junior Kelly Held, who dreamed up the fundraiser and made it happen. We have reached the end of our 2021-22 program year. Today, we say goodbye to our chancel choir until the fall. Many thanks to director and organist Craig Tucker, our soloists, and our additional choir members who brought us such joy and inspiration when they began singing again. How about a round of applause? we will miss you. We will have great music in the summer, since individual soloists will serenade us every Sunday. Our programs for children and youth will resume in September, as will our adult education events. We would now like to invite everyone who is able to stand and greet those around you. And we have one additional announcement this morning. At 11:30 with Lisa Lawson Hill, we have a discussion of A Woman of Words downstairs, and we hope everyone who can will join. Okay. And now, to read our scripture lesson, we have DJ Diliberto, who is somewhere. Where does DJ go? There she is. Thank you very much, DJ.
Good morning. Today's scripture lesson begins with Psalms 118, verses 1 through 3, and continues with Psalms 18, verses 1 through 3. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, God's steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. I love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. In the reading of these words, may we hear the word of the Lord. Amen.
Okay, thank you for bearing with me. There was just some technical difficulties in that I lost my sermon, which was terrifying for a moment, but it's all good. Let's join together in reading our call to prayer. We are created in the image of God. We walk in the presence of God. We live surrounded by the love of God. In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to God. God of life, restoration, and redemption, in the face of grief, you share our tears. So to you we raise our hopes and fears. Be with us in the silence of our hearts. Bend your ear to hear our needs and wants. Lead us through pain and help us to trust that when all else fails, your love will still remain. You are nearer than our breathing, all earthly joys exceeding. We lift up those we love, knowing that your Spirit is in our midst and not just up above. Enfold the world in your tender care. Help each other our burdens bear. Until the world is with you one, we ask these things through your beloved Son. Heavenly Father, please be with those who are traveling to Houston, Texas for the youth mission trip. Grant them a safe and peaceful flight. Be with Jimmy and Colleen as they help work the Pride March, and keep that event free from any danger or potential discrimination. I also ask that you care for every member of our community today and all of the personal intentions or desires that they hold in the silence of their hearts. Let us take a moment of silence to ask God for our personal intentions and for the needs of those in our lives. We ask this all in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
When we want to express something of great importance, we oftentimes run up against the limitations of language. No matter how hard you try, it is impossible to squash the beauty of a sunset or the agony of first love into a neatly constructed sentence. While language can be descriptive, it is often futile at explaining the things most important to us. And if language fails flat trying to sum up a sunset, it must be utterly impotent when it comes to explaining God, an infinite and ineffable subject matter. Perhaps this is why St. Augustine is famous for saying, "Si comprehendus, non es Deus," which means, "If you understand, it is not God." The second we claim to have mastery over God in language or knowledge, we've fallen short of the very thing we're trying to describe. You can't claim full understanding or explanation of God, but we can try, and our efforts to understand and talk about God are well documented, to say the least. Since it is so difficult to speak about God within the confines of traditional language, theological poetry can be a beautiful and perhaps more applicable way to approach an infinite subject matter. The example par excellence of theological poetry is the Book of Psalms. The Psalms are the hymn book of ancient Israel, composed of their most raw and triumphant prayers. In the Psalms, we see a plethora of metaphors and similes. One of the most difficult to understand and perhaps underrated metaphors for God is a rock. Rocks don't necessarily seem divine. As any child who's ever had a pet rock knows, rocks are quite boring, especially when you wanted a puppy instead. Like, this thing just, if I told you this was God, I think you'd all think I was crazy. In It's the Great Pumpkin, Charlie Brown, when Charlie Brown receives rock after rock on Halloween night, it's clear he's not leaping for joy. He sighs despondent as each lump of stone falls into his trick-or-treat bag, and I got a rock. Indeed, there's nothing godly or glorious about a bag full of rocks. Perhaps that's why such a metaphor does so little for our modern imagination. We don't correlate rocks with anything positive. Rather, they are synonymous with the dull and mundane. Well, friends, this is a loss for us. The metaphorical description of God as rock can be quite rich and spiritually nourishing. So this morning, let's take some time to unpack what we mean by comparing God to a rock, and how the psalmists make use of this comparison to illustrate a central tenet of Israel's theology, that God's benevolence endures forever. God's benevolence enduring forever provides us with great delight and comfort. And so it's worth taking some time to really delve in and understand what this means. The Hebrew word used in Psalm 18 for rock is selah, which can be translated as security or stronghold, connoting a place of great protection and refuge. Right off the bat, this type of rock is drastically different from a gag gift pet or world's most depressing trick-or-treat trick. When I think about the image of an enduring, eternal rock, I can't help but reflect on one of my favorite places as a child, Big Rock. Big Rock was one of the central landmarks of my childhood. It stood at roughly 3 feet wide and 5 feet tall, with a couple of divots in the slate gray stone, the perfect size for small sneakers to climb. Big Rock sat in the sprawling grass of the Planting Fields Arboretum. Maybe some of you have been there and seen it before. It was one of my mother's favorite places to take me on afternoon adventures after nursery school. We'd buy a pack of cream cookies from the vending machine by the restrooms and split them while sitting on top of Big Rock. And then I'd climb, to the top and jump off over and over again as the sun sank lower in the sky. Big Rock was like a mountain in my small eyes, a mighty height to ascend. Standing on top of Big Rock, I felt like I was on top of the world, like my tiny little hands could scoop the clouds. During the autumn season, I'd collect the acorns that fell from the oak trees just above Big Rock and draw little faces on them, decorating their acorn hats and creating elaborate fantasy worlds. My mother would tell me how many autumns Big Rock must have seen, how many children must have jumped and climbed and played there too. Big Rock was also the place where my mother was finally able to reach cell reception on 9/11. My memory of that dark day is hazy as I was so young at the time, but I vividly remember sitting next to my mother on the smooth stone peak of Big Rock when she gasped in shock upon learning that the second tower had fallen. During the peak of COVID, we made many family trips to the Planting Fields Arboretum, and it was oddly comforting to see Big Rock still standing despite the world seeming to crumble around us. Big Rock still stands today, I'm happy to admit, although it looks a lot smaller as I've grown taller. It's a reminder of something eternal and steadfast, something grounding. All the changes of the world, all the traumas of society, all of our communal and personal griefs and healings have done nothing to alter this immovable stone. So far, we have established something fairly basic. Rocks are an important landmark geographically. They serve as a metaphor for things that are eternal and enduring. Rocks are strong. They stand firm against the shifting sands of time. Because of this, rocks serve as a beautiful icon of God's steadfastness. Just as we feel secure standing upon Big Rock, and this Big Rock we call Earth, we can feel secure placing our lives on God, the Rock of Ages. But you might be thinking, well, Phoebe, this does sound nice, but perhaps it's a bit naive. Referring to God as a rock can seem simplistic and childish, but the image becomes more nuanced and powerful when set within its original context, Israel's hymnody, the Book of Psalms. The psalmist could be called many things, but naive certainly isn't one of them. They cried out to God in the midst of great public and personal heartbreak, suffering, death, loss, war, slavery, and oppression. They do not claim to have dominion over theology, rather, they articulate the depths of a faith lived and reasoned with in the midst of life. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann writes, "The spirituality of the Psalms assumes that the world is called to question in conversation with God. That permits and requires that our conversation with God be vigorous, candid, and daring. God assumes different roles in these conversations. At times, God is the guarantor of the old equilibrium. At other times, God is the harbinger of new justice to be established. And at other times still," Brueggemann concludes, "God is in the disorientation, being sovereign in ways that does not quite strike us as adequate. We might wish for God removed from such a dynamic, for a spirituality not inclined to conflict. But the Psalms rejects such a way, with God as false to our daily lives, false to the memories of this people, who do not know that they belong to the Egyptian Empire, but who hope for a new equilibrium, for a new kingdom, for new justice and new righteousness. Over the Psalter, they insist passionately, vigorously, and with boldness that God's justice must be done. For this very reason, the Psalter always includes tension. God is a rock and a fortress, yes, but the psalmist is clinging to these image of God in the midst of enemies, in the midst of real threats and real iniquities. Brueggemann insists that the Psalms fall into three types. First, we have Psalms of orientation, which enumerate God's goodness and providential care. Then, Psalms of disorientation, which cry out to God in the midst of suffering and anguish. Lastly, there are Psalms of new orientation, which exult in shock and awe at God's surprising care despite the apparent disorder of the world. Why would Israel's hymnody contain such a mess of contradictions? So many songs of terror amidst ones toting blessed reassurance in the arms of God. Well, the problem with a hymnody that focuses purely on equilibrium, coherence, and symmetry is that it might deceive and cover up. Life is not like that. Life is also savagely marked by disequilibrium, incoherence, and unrivaled asymmetry. If our faith is unable to confront these realities, then it is not faith at all. It is merely a childish delusion. The Psalms of Orientation assert that God is gracious, merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and compassionate. The Psalms are simple affirmations of God's goodness and providential care, the praises of a child not yet disillusioned by the world with its many injustices. When we recite them, we call to mind the image of God as a good father who acts for our benefit, whose power and might work for us. The Psalms of Disorientation provide a shadow side to these features, but one that is no less true. They claim that God possesses a jealous wrath, one that is abounding in anger, but also compassion, salvation, and glory, but also vengeance. Brueggemann opines, "The two-sidedness of God's person here is noteworthy. God expresses anger, destructive indignation, exposed as wrath, anger, vengeance, and power. But it is matched by God's compassion, salvation, deliverance, and forgiveness. The mystery of this God is the juxtaposition of vengeance and compassion. Both vengeance and compassion matter here." The final grouping of Psalms, the Psalms of New Orientation, express the triumph of God's steadfast love. These Psalms recognize that God does not operate in the same economy as mortals. "So we see now that the payoffs of God are not exacting," Brueggemann writes, "but stunningly generous. Steadfast love is the basis for God's goodness. The result is that God shatters all expectations and does not treat us as we might anticipate. God utilizes the generosity and concern of a caring father. The ground for this newness of life, salvation, and deliverance lies not in the neediness of Israel, but in the will of a loving father." Steadfast love is a description of God's rock-like sovereign dependability that carries over through all three phases of the Psalms. God is steadfast love in tender and providential care, but also through the exacting of justice, the mystery of contradiction, and the new life brought about through salvation. That is why the image of God as rock is able to endure the test of doubt and despair. God is only trustworthy because God is steadfast in love. To be a human is to be dependent on things outside of ourselves. Because of our dependence, we need something steadfast. If we could not trust in gravity, we would be floating about aimlessly. If we could not count on the seasons, our crops would not grow. We are reliant on nature, on the laws that govern the natural world, for our survival. But we are also, and perhaps more fundamentally, reliant on God's preservation. We did not create ourselves, and so we do not sustain ourselves. This sense of dependence makes many people uncomfortable, so they try to deny it by exacting control over their lives in other ways, procuring enough money, fame, power, good health, prestige, to numb the reality of their finitude. Nothing, however, will change this fact. We are mortal, dependent creatures. Without rain, sunlight, shelter, food, and ultimately God's sustaining power, we simply fall out of existence. There's nothing that we can do to make ourselves exist or make ourselves continue to exist. We are utterly reliant on God. The psalmists rejoice in God's steadfast love because it's the only guarantor of our existence, because God alone is the bedrock and preservation of our lives. But wait, there's more. God's role as rock extends beyond just this life. To bring our conversation about the Psalms into a Christological context, we can say with confidence, God's steadfast love is the basis for the resurrection. It is only because God is sovereign, faithful, and steadfast, that we can have any hope at all. God's steadfast love, like a rock, will endure beyond our earthly lives. And just like Big Rock has outlived hundreds of generations, so will God's steadfast love outlive the frailty and failings of our mortal flesh. If we want to believe in a love which demands eternity, it can only be the love of a God who is steadfast and endures forever. To close our reflections of God as our rock, I would like to read a quote from the theologian Karl Barth. This passage comes from his work on providence in the section, The Divine Preserving. The language here is a bit technical, but if you listen closely and carefully, it is the best summation of what we mean when we talk about how God's steadfast love endures forever. Barth writes, "The eternal preservation of the creature means positively that it can continue eternally before God. God is the one who was and is to come. With God, the past is future, and both past and future are present. There is nothing that God could not perceive of or know of. All that began to be and was preserved, is preserved by God. Nothing could escape God or perish. Everything was open and present to God, everything within its own time and within its own limits, but everything open and present to God. Similarly, everything that is, as well as everything that was open and present to God within its own limits. And everything that will be, as well as everything that was and is, will be open and present to God within its own limits. And one day, to speak in temporal terms, when the totality of everything that was and is and will be will only have been, then in the totality of its temporal duration, it will still be open and present to God, and therefore eternally preserved. Eternally preserved, revealed in all of its greatness and littleness, judged according to its rightness or wrongness, its value or lack of value, but revealed in its participation in the love of God, which God has directed towards it. Therefore, nothing will escape God. No aspect in the great game of creation, no moment of human life, no thinking thought, no word spoken, no secret or insignificant enterprise, no deed or omission with all of its interactions and efforts, no suffering or joy, no sincerity or lie, no secret event in heaven or too well-known event on earth, no ray of sunlight, no note which has ever sounded, no color which has ever been revealed, possibly in the darkness of oceanic depths where the eye of man could never perceive it, no wing beats of the day fly in the far-flung epochs of geological time. Everything will be present to God exactly as it was or will be, in all of its reality, in the whole temporal course of its activity, in its strength or its weakness, in the majesty or meanness. God will not allow anything to perish, but will hold it in the hollow of God's own hand, as God has always done and will always do. God will not be alone in eternity, no, but with the creature. God will allow it to partake in God's own eternal life. And in this way, the creature will continue to be, in its limitations, even in its limited temporal duration. How could it not be when it is open and present to God, even at its end? Even as that which has only been, that is how it will persist. In all the unrest of its being in time, it will be unfolded by the rest of God, and in God it will itself be at rest, just as now, even in all the unrest, it is hidden and can be at rest in the rest of God. This is the eternal preservation of God, as we read in the Psalms repeated again and again, for his mercy endureth forever. Amen."